be together to share a time of worship, especially since the weather's a lot better than it was last week. For those of you who don't know, some sad news this week, I'm afraid. At the beginning of the week, I heard that Diana McMurray has died. And then just day before yesterday, Jean, Betty Ingham also passed away. Please remember the family of both these ladies, who were staunch supporters of the church for many, many, many a year. Remember the families in your prayers this week. We hear you calling us, Lord, over the busy clamour of the day. Give us grace to pause and be still. Still our minds preoccupied with self-esteem. Still our gaze to see with your joy the wonder of your creation. Guide our seeing and our hearing, our words and our actions, to the quiet place of your presence. Stir in our hearts a new passion, a passion for justice and peace, grounded in your wisdom, a wisdom that we can faithfully pass on to others. So we sing our first hymn, which is number 97, based on Psalm 139. O God, you search me and you know me. Accepting the responsibility this places upon us to love one another as you have loved us. We meet as your lights in this dark world and pray that through our words and our lives, others might be drawn into your family and accept you as their Saviour and Lord. In our meeting together, let us remember that we worship the God who created this world, the God who spoke through prophets from generation to generation, led people from captivity to liberty, healed the sick, fed the hungry, and was faithful even when faced with rejection. The same God who wants all people to be drawn into God's love and grace, to know forgiveness and the joy of salvation. Let us put aside all that hinders and join together in worship and praise. Forgive us when we turn away from you, when we are distracted by our worldly cares, when we are wrapped up in ourselves, when we fail to pass on the good news. Forgive us when we fail to hear your words, when we are distracted by our own voice, when we are unthinking about the things we do and are unmoved by the cries of the suffering. Forgive us that we have not the eyes to see the wonder and awe of your creation and the radiance of your everlasting light, because we are gazing inwardly, selfishly looking after number one. And so we pray that the words of our mouths and the love stored in our hearts will stir us into action to care for the world and its creatures, to bring peace to the world and its peoples. Amen. It's a story I heard the other day. A story about a wee girl called Carol who came to church. And she was only 3 years old, and it was her first time ever in church. But her mum and dad had told her how it was to be, how she should behave in church, and what she should do and shouldn't do. And Carol was as good as gold all the time she was there, except when the minister was saying a prayer. She said something then, not once, but several times. And she said it in a small voice so that only her mum and dad and the minister could hear it. She said, "Mr. Gray, stop talking. Mr. Gray, stop talking. Mr. Gray, stop talking." And the minister, Mr. Gray, was astonished because he knew that her parents had taught her what was to be done in church. But after church, he asked her, "Carol, in church, when I was praying, why did you keep saying stop talking?" And the wee girl replied, "Mommy and Daddy say it's rude to talk in church." Which, of course, is true. If you're talking about what you watched on TV last night or where you're going on holiday. But it's not true if we're talking to God or listening for him to speak. In other words, when we're praying, there's a time and a place to speak and a time and a place to listen, a time to sing and a time to pray. And one thing we can be quite sure of is that God is always ready to listen when we speak, wherever and whoever we are. So let's sing again. Number 378, Praise to the Holiest in the Heart, 378.
Thank you. Our Old Testament lesson comes from the book of Proverbs, Proverbs chapter 3, starting at verse 5. Trust in the Lord with all your heart, and lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways acknowledge him, and he will make your paths straight. Do not be wise in your own eyes. Fear the Lord and shun evil. This will bring health to your body and nourishment to your bones. And then verse 13. Blessed is the man who finds wisdom, the man who gains understanding. For she is more profitable than silver and yields better returns than gold. She is more precious than rubies. Nothing you desire can compare with her. Long life is in her right hand. And her left hand are riches and honor. Her ways are pleasant ways, and all her paths are peace. Our New Testament lesson comes from the book of James, James chapter 3, starting at verse 1. Taming the tongue. Not many of you should presume to be teachers, my brothers, because you know that we who teach will be judged more strictly. We all stumble in many ways. If anyone is never at fault in what he says, he is a perfect man, able to keep the whole body in check. When we put bits in the mouths of horses to make them obey us, we can turn the whole animal. Or take ships as an example. Although they are so large and driven by strong winds, they are steered by a very small rudder wherever the pilot wants to go. Likewise, the tongue is a small part of the body, but it greatly boasts. Consider what a great forest is set on fire by a small spark. The tongue also is a fire, a world of evil among parts of the body. It corrupts the whole person, sets the whole course of his life on fire, and is itself set on fire by hell. All kinds of animals, birds, reptiles, and creatures of the sea are being tamed and have been tamed by man. But no man can tame the tongue. It is a restless evil full of deadly poison. With the tongue we praise our Lord and Father, and with it we curse men who have been made in God's likeness. Out of the same mouth come praise and curses. My brothers, this should not be. Can both fresh water and salt water flow from the same spring? My brothers, can a fig tree bear olives, or a grapevine bear figs? Neither can a salt spring produce fresh water. May God add to us his blessing to these readings from his word. Amen.
Still got the mic. Thank you, Helen. It's not easy to juggle We sing again. Number 465. Be thou my vision, O Lord of my heart. 465. Sustaining us each day. You are with us in our journeying and in our resting, our companion and teacher along the way. You, Lord, are our hope and our strength. Your grace fills everything and everywhere. The sound of your handiwork resounds in all things. Your mysteries, breadth and depth, exhaust our understanding. In your presence, we taste the bread of life, the living water that quenches our thirst, that sustains us and fills our hearts with grateful thanks. Father God, Peter confessed you as Messiah, but lacked understanding of who you truly were. Give us wisdom to proclaim your redeeming love, to teach others, to advance your kingdom, regardless of the cost. May your church be filled with songs of praise for the glory of the work of your hands. May our hearts open to your love and our ears to the wisdom of your word. Now we pray for others. We pray for all those who influence our lives, those in places of government, in broadcasting and publishing, in politics and civic life, that they may be blessed with your wisdom in all that they do. Guide all who preach and teach in your name what is true, noble, pure and wonderful, that they may help us to see your plan to make all things new. We give thanks for those who have accompanied us in our faith journey, who supported us when we've lacked confidence, and gladdened our hearts with your wisdom and understanding. We pray for all who are fearful and anxious, who doubt your love and find themselves in a dark place, who struggle with illness in mind, body, or spirit. When we struggle with words, take the intention of our hearts in our promise to pray. We give thanks for those who have given their lives in the confession of their faith and rest with you in glory. Give us grace to confess our faith in Christ crucified, and give us strength to overcome our fears when we offer ourselves to be the faithful servants of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. We sing again, number 595. O breath of life, come sweeping through us. 595. Churchyard stands a drab, grey, drab sandstone tombstone, and the faint etchings read, "Beneath this stone, a lump of clay, lies Arabella Young, who, on the 24th of May, began to hold her tongue. Let's hope that we learn the lesson that that woman never did, to tame our tongue. As a wise man observed, as you go through life, you're going to have many opportunities to keep your mouth shut. Take advantage of all of them. What do you think the most powerful part of the human body is? Maybe our bulging biceps, or our beating heart, or our amazing brain? Did you know, for example, that our brain processes 70,000 thoughts a day? Or that our heart pumps 2,000 gallons of blood every 24 hours? How do they get these numbers? So those bits of our body are amazing, but James tells us today that there's an even more powerful part, our tongues. And the human tongue accounts for under 1% of our body mass, but it punches well above its weight, because we use our tongues to speak, and our words can have huge effects. Our words can be a powerful force for good or evil. In our reading today, James compares our tongues to some other small objects that can have a disproportionate effect. In verse 3, he says, "When we put bits into the mouths of horses to make them obey us, we can turn the whole animal." So a little piece of metal can make a huge horse change direction. And verse 4 says, "Take ships as an example. Although they are so large and are driven by strong winds, they are steered by a very small rudder wherever the pilot wants to go." So a small rudder can determine whether a whole ship stays afloat or crashes onto the rocks. And in verse 5, James tells us that just a small spark can set a whole forest on fire. So just a small match, or as we know here on Arran, just a throwaway barbecue can create an inferno. Small things can have big effects, including our tongues. Whenever we open our mouths to speak, something we do, it says on average 700 times a day, we are wielding a powerful force. Good words can lift our spirits, encourage us, inform us, and inspire us. But bad words can break a heart, sow division, or drive us to despair. Friendships and careers, marriages, churches can all be damaged by bad words. Wrong words can indeed be weapons of mass destruction. In verse 1, it says people who use their tongue to teach have a particularly responsible job. We will be strictly judged for what we say. Teachers in schools, ministers in churches, and parents of children have a huge responsibility to use words well. But whether we're teachers or not, our words must always be chosen carefully. They can have a huge effect on others, both for good and for bad. We all know the popular saying, "Sticks and stones may break my bones, but names will never hurt me." But the trouble is, that's actually not true. Wrong words can be incredibly hurtful. And we've all been hurt at some time by critical comments or harsh words, bullying or bad language. So James says that our unruly tongues need to be tamed. In verse 7, all kinds of animals, birds, reptiles and sea creatures are being tamed and have been tamed by mankind, but no human being can tame the tongue. Our tongues need to be brought under control. We need to make sure that we say the right thing at the right time. And as James says in verse 10, out of the same mouth come praise and cursing. My brothers and sisters, this should not be. We should be consistently careful and wise in what we say. But that is incredibly hard. We all say wrong things sometimes, and we find it really hard to keep our tongue under control. And actually, James says that it is impossible for us to tame our tongue. On our own, we can't always say what's right. We don't have the power to be perfect. In verse 2 today, it says we are all at fault for some of the things we've said. So human beings can tame lions and birds of prey, but we can't control our own tongues. And that's because the Bible says our speech shows our heart. And to change our words, we need a change of heart. And that's the point James is making in verses 11 and 12 today, when he says, can both fresh water and salt water flow from the same spring? My brothers and sisters, can a fig tree bear olives or an olive grapevine bear figs? Neither can a salt spring produce fresh water. So what James is saying that is that the plant produces its own fruit. A grapevine produces grapes, a fig tree produces figs. You don't see oranges on an apple tree or plums on a pear tree. And elsewhere in nature, a salt spring can only spurt out salt water. It can't produce pure water. In the same way, our words are the fruit from our heart. They spring out of our soul. If we find ourselves speaking bad words, it shows that there's something wrong in our heart. And to tame the tongue, we need a new heart. A wee story from home. We live in an old farmhouse with a correspondingly old drainage system, which last year blocked. And so the game was to find out where the drains actually are. So John spent a long, long time, many days and weeks, digging up large areas of our lawn, our veg garden, and the paddock in order to trace the drains that were backing up to our field ditch. And until he got to the source or heart of the blockage, he couldn't solve the problem. In a similar way, to tame our tongues, we need to go to the source, and that means having a change of heart. Jesus himself taught this, just as James does. In Matthew chapter 12, Jesus says, make a tree good, and its fruit will be good. Or make a tree bad, and the fruit will be bad. For a tree is recognized by its fruit. The mouth speaks what the heart is full of. A good man brings good things out of the good stored up in him, and an evil man brings evil things out of the evil stored up in him. And there's only one being who can perform the heart surgery that every human needs, and that is God's Holy Spirit. Whenever someone becomes a Christian and first puts their faith in Jesus, God's Spirit enters their heart and begins to change it. It's what Jesus famously called being born again. And when God's Spirit gets to work on our hearts, our words will change as a result. As our heart is transformed by God, so will our tongue be tamed. In fact, some of the most visible fruit of the Spirit in our lives will be a change in how and what we say. If we're eager to grow as disciples of Jesus, we should be eager and impatient to see improvements in our speech as God's Spirit gets to work. So how do we use our tongues well? What does good and godly speech look like? How can we serve Jesus with our lips as well as with our lives? Well, we can serve Jesus with our speech by praising God, encouraging each other, and by sharing the gospel. So firstly, our tongues should be used to praise God. In verse 9 today, James tells us that when we praise our Lord and Father, we are putting our tongues to very good use. Our first duty as Christians is to worship the Lord who made us and saved us. And we can praise him in prayer and sing songs to God in gratitude for all he's given us. Secondly, we should use our lips to encourage our fellow Christians. In Hebrews, it tells us to spur one another on towards love and good deeds. While Colossians calls on Christians to teach and admonish one another with all wisdom. So when we gather together in church on Sundays, we should not grumble or gossip, criticize or condemn, but try to encourage each other. And thirdly and finally, we should use our tongues to share the gospel with non-Christian friends and family. The New Testament tells us to always be ready to give a reason for the hope that we have, to always be willing to mention Jesus' name. When you think about it, the most loving words we can ever share with someone are words about Jesus Christ. Words about the one person who can save us from sin, steer us through life, and grant eternal life beyond the grave. So, an acronym for all of us to remember. Think before you speak. T, is it true? H, is it helpful? I, is it inspiring? N, is it necessary? And K, is it kind? Let's use our tongues to praise God, to encourage one another, and to share the gospel. Let's come to prayer once more now as we dedicate our offerings by saying the Lord's Prayer together. Let us pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory forever. Amen. Our closing hymn is number 220. The day thou gavest, Lord, is ended. 220.
Thank you.
May God, the giver of all good gifts, fill us with his wisdom and the understanding of his will. May he fulfill our just desire for the prosperity of our hard work. May his spirit reign on this island and in all places, and may he give peace in our time. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon us and remain with us always.